Good afternoon.
How's everybody on this beautiful day? I guess we've turned the corner. You want to call it that?
Hope so.
Hope so. Sir, there's a handout for you there by the windowsill. This is, in fact, today is what? The third? Yeah, Thursday. Represents the centennial, or 100th anniversary, if you want to call it that. Of America's entry into what's popularly known as World War I, the Great War, the war to end all wars. Of course, that's a misnomer, since Versailles is probably the biggest hoax ever perpetrated on modern man. But it's the centennial of our entry into that war. Interesting, when Woodrow Wilson asked for that declaration of war as prescribed in our Constitution, how many presidents do that anymore?
None.
Zero. At least we're consistent. On April 2nd, took Congress 4 days to discuss this. 4 days. However, if you fast forward to December 8, when Roosevelt went before Congress, boy, that one didn't take too long to do. Of course, that's understandable. But what you see with April 6th is, number one, anyone who's attended my past talks, previous talks, or attended my classes at Norwalk Community College knows I don't believe in World War I or World War II. There's really only one war. It starts 1914, takes a break in 1918. Hitler and Stalin, with Stalin's connivance, jumpstart this conflict in 1939, and it ends in 1945 with a 21-year hiatus. You know, this war is started by these European colonial powers. It's really a European civil war. That's what this is. That's exactly what this is, and then morphs into a global conflict. A global conflict which will not be won or ended by these Europeans, but by outsiders, the United States and the Soviet Union. They win it. They will win this war in the end, and they will change the globe. To the point that no longer will these European colonial powers dictate the military, political, strategic, economic agenda. That's going to be done now by two other countries, although in 1945, more so one of them. And that's the United States and the Soviet Union. The Europeans are done. They're finished. War's changed. The globe has changed. And we're going to get into this, how this war got beyond, in particular, the British and the French. Why? Age of Industrial Revolution, this evolution of capitalism. It changed everything. Technology here. I mean, now we're talking about, you know, these monarchs, these monarchs who were still in place, 1914 to 19, we'll say 1917, because the Romanovs are really the first casualty here. They're going to be gone after having been around three centuries. Now they're gone. And so you see some of these monarchs, such as the Romanovs, such as the Habsburgs, who had been around when you had serfs and feudalism, trying to exist in a world of the Industrial Revolution, capitalism. Most people now aren't tied to the, well, many people aren't tied to the land anymore. You know, this new clique of rich, which is undermining the nobility, a growing middle class. Now you got people with a few bucks in their pocket. They're not tied to the land. They're mobile. How are these monarchs going to hold on to these people? Politics are changing. Republic, democracy, socialism, communism, fascism's going to come on the scene. The world is changing. How are these monarchs going to survive in this kind of a world? They're not. They're dinosaurs. And they're going to be extinct 1918. That's what this war helps to do. But America's presence in this? Interesting. We are now taking our presence on the world stage. Congress codifies this on April 6, 1917. It is a day in the history of this country, it is a day of greater significance than either December 7th, 1941 or September 11, 2001. And JFC Fuller couldn't have said it better, the noted British general slash historian. This day not only changes American history, it changes European history, and it changes world history. Has America got out of European affairs since April 6, 1917? No. Ukraine ring a bell here? Yeah. Yeah, interesting what you see here. But the question is, how'd you get to this juncture or this intersection here in world history? How'd you get here? Well, let's go back to the beginning of the 19th century. Louisiana Purchase, there's a good starting point, 1803. Louisiana Purchase, what was that? Well, Jefferson bought the Louisiana Territory, right? He doubled the size of this nation overnight. If anything assured American imperialism, boy, that was it. That was it. You know, and of course the question is, well, why did Napoleon give up all that territory? Well, go back to Haiti. You know, the Haitian Revolution, that successful black revolution. And what happened? The French got tossed out. And when they got tossed out, what happened to a lot of their sugar trade? Sugar is almost like gold back then. You know, the Europeans had a sweet tooth. And so without that extra money, and with Napoleon looking to engage in his wars in Europe, the Napoleonic Wars, what does he have to do?
Raise cash. Money.
That's it, raise cash. That's it. For 15 million bucks, Jefferson buys the Louisiana Territory. 3 cents an acre, what a deal. However, $11,250,000 of that is cash. The other $3,750,000 is a forgiveness of French debt. So that money really doesn't leave the country. You know, Americans holding French debt, we pay them off, we're done. However, Napoleon has money now to pay for his wars in Europe. However, it's like a British admiral once stated that some British thought it was a shame that the United States and Britain would go to war in the War of 1812. But one British admiral said, there's something the Americans don't seem to realize. What happens if Napoleon wins in Europe? What's to stop him coming back here and grabbing that territory? Nobody, nothing. And in essence, he says that the Royal Navy are the Alps for the United States. Boy, is that a strong statement or what? Yeah, the Royal Navy, you know, that shield of His Majesty or Her Majesty, who's ever sitting on the throne, it's the sword of the empire. It's what it is. Just like the Imperial Japanese Navy will later be the sword of the emperor or the Japanese Empire. Now, whenever a country indulges in naval power, what are they looking to do? Extend influence beyond their borders. China come to mind today? Aren't they buying and building a larger navy? Yeah, they are. They're following that progression. And so you see here with the United States, we double in size overnight. It's virtually assured that we're going to go beyond the Mississippi River across those virgin lands. And you know who else sees this? The Spanish. Boy, their position in Florida is in jeopardy at this point. Their position in Florida is in jeopardy at this point. And they know what's going to come down the pike. Going west. I mean, it's virtually assured. Interesting what you see here. It's fascinating. But this is an example of American imperialism. It doesn't make any difference whether you open your wallets to grab this territory or shed blood by committing troops. Who lived there? Indians? They don't care if it's the British, the Spanish, the French, or Americans. Weren't they there before any of those invaders? Yeah, they were. So who's going to take it on the chin in the end? The Indian. Is this imperialism? Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. That's exactly what this is. However, in the War of 1812, it's interesting here. Well, you know, one of the reasons we get into that war, you learned this in school, right? The snatching of seamen off American ships. Remember that one? Yeah. Of course, let's understand that, too. Part of this is there were a number of British sailors coming to the United States because of the draconian approach to discipline is one reason they're going to do that in the British Navy. You know, these British Navy captains had the authority. They could even stop a British merchant ship if they didn't have enough men in their crew. We're taking you. Yeah, they could do that. They could go into pubs and do this.
Let's go Shanghai, right?
That's a pretty good word for it. That's a pretty good word for it. And so one historian mentioned there were upwards, you know, at the end of the American Revolution, up to the War of 1812, some 10,000 British men, seamen, came to the United States. Of course, that leads to an issue, what? Immigration? Yeah, aren't you supposed to fill out the paperwork here and be a naturalized American citizen, right? Well, back in the day, you could buy that paperwork for a buck. Fill it out, you're an American citizen. However, that said, the British would stop American ships. They're looking for British seamen. Of course, they're not going to be too particular on who they take. If you're a strapping young guy, gee, this guy looks good. He could have been a native-born American. Native-born American. You know, I read in some of these history books, I remember in school, well, the British had snatched some 3,500 seamen. Do you know that the British government will return about 3,000? Having ascertained their origins, that they were actually native-born Americans, they returned them. So the real number of seamen snatched off American ships, I would agree with some naval historians who say it's closer to 7, 8, or 9,000. You know, the exact number is hard to determine. However, that's not the only thing going on here. You know, between 1803 and 1808, keep in mind the Napoleonic Wars are going on. Americans are looking to trade with anybody. And so what happened? What's the Royal Navy doing? Snatching American ships too? It's estimated between 1803 and 1808, some 500 American ships were confiscated. 200 more by the French. And yet, the New England shipping interests figured out they were making enough money to the point that if three ships, were confiscated, that one ship get through, they still made money. They still made money. Of course, that doesn't help the seamen on these ships. But the New England shipping interests are making money. Interesting how this is. But we go to war with the British. Now, here is a chance, you know, 1812, Napoleon fails at Moscow. He takes Moscow, but he can't hold it. Is that shades of what's coming down the road here in 1941? Some people say it is. But anyway, Napoleon will be pushed back 1813 going into Europe, and then he's going to collapse in 1815. But here you see the United States and Britain go to war, which is kind of a backwater to the Napoleonic conflicts going on in Europe. And by 1814, the British want to end this. They're going to put paid to the United States and get rid of what some Tories used to call us, that grimy thumbprint of a republic. It doesn't work. It doesn't work. Number one, they were going to invade from Canada down toward Plattsburgh, right? And the roads aren't all that great at this point. No, America's not a well-developed country. The roads are what, dirt in those forests? There's still very few cities in this country then. What do you have? Boston, New York, Philadelphia, Baltimore, Charleston, if you want to throw that in. There aren't very much in the way of cities. So the infrastructure is not too well developed here. And so the United States Navy was able to hold on to Lake Champlain and defeat a British force. And the British Army does not proceed south. Control of the seas, well, control of a lake, determines what's going to be known as the Battle of Plattsburgh. That invasion's off. The British do burn down Washington, but they're stopped at Baltimore and have to retreat. And then, of course, there's the Battle of New Orleans, which everyone knows about from school. But that battle actually occurs after the Treaty of Ghent is signed. You know, communications were slow. It's not to take anything away from Jackson and how he fought that battle. That's not the issue here. The issue here is the battle's fought after the war is technically over. But again, communications are slow. There's no internet. There's no tweets here. It doesn't exist. And so the battle is fought. Jackson won. He's a big hero. Understandable here. But the Duke of Wellington will tell the British negotiators at Ghent after the Plattsburgh debacle and after Baltimore, we can't take control of the Great Lakes. And since we can't take control of the Great Lakes, we can't slice off some of New York and attach it to Canada, and we can't stop the Americans from continuing into the Ohio Valley and going west. So you might as well make a deal here. And so they do, and the Treaty of Ghent will be signed December 1814. But what's interesting here is what comes out of this. What are some of the most what are the biggest spurs toward another war? Religion? Politics? How about loss of territory? Isn't that a big spur toward another war? I mean, you can't tell me there aren't Germans that want slices of Poland back. And you can't tell me there aren't, beg your pardon?
France.
Ah, France, there we go. Yes, indeedy. Or there aren't Poles that want some of Ukraine back? Or Ukrainians that want part of Poland back? Or how about some people crossing the border, Texas? You don't think there aren't some of those people that want Texas, New Mexico, Arizona, California, part of Colorado back? I said that at one talk, and I mentioned Texas. Let them have it. One in every crowd, right? One in every crowd. And so you see here with the War of 1812, nobody lost territory. What's there to fight over? Nobody lost territory. And so John Quincy Adams, one of the signers of the Treaty of Ghent, said, I hope this is the last peace treaty we ever have to sign with the British. Have we ever fought with the British again after this? It's over 200 years. Was he right? Yeah, but why? Neither side lost territory. Did we get Canada? No. Did we lose part of New York? No. So what's there to fight over? What's there to fight over? And then in 1815, Britain and the United States sit down and discuss fishing rights off Newfoundland. They sit down and discuss these issues peacefully. 1817, the Rush-Bagot Treaty. You know, the British were going to start putting a few warships on Lake Champlain and Lake Ontario, so on and so forth. So the United States government sits down with the British. Hey, why don't we discuss this? I'll tell you what we'll do. You know, why don't each of us have one 100-ton vessel with an 18-pounder gun on Lake Champlain, one each on Lake Ontario, and two other such ships near the Great Lakes. Yeah, okay, what a deal. And they sign off on this. 1818, the Oregon Territory out west, they agree to a joint occupation. You know, there's no shooting here. They're talking out their problems or talking out their issues. They agree to the border between the United States and Canada, out to the Oregon Territory in the end, basically the border you see today. We have to give up a little territory in Minnesota, the British have to give up a little territory in Canada, but they agree basically to how you see the border now. They sit down and they talk about this. Keep in mind one of the reasons why. Now, in Europe, following the Napoleonic Wars, you've seen a new balance of power erected. Napoleon has been defeated. These monarchs want to create a new balance of power. So what happens here? Well, Tsarist Russia, the Habsburgs, and then the Prussian monarch will oversee Eastern and Central Europe. The French, when they're readmitted into the balance of power, the Bourbons are back on the throne. They'll oversee part of Western Europe and part of Italy, which the Austrians will also do. You know, the Papal States will come back because Napoleon's gone and so on, and these other principalities in the Italian boot. And then the British will oversee everything else. But what about the Spanish? Remember the Spanish monarchs? Yeah, sure, what happened to them? They're out, because in 1808, Napoleon invades Spain. What happened to that empire they had down Central and South America? All these people are gonna bolt. They're gonna bolt. And so the Spanish are going to lose that, you know, remember when they get all the gold and silver out of Central and South America, that gravy train of galleons going back and forth? I mean, that went on for centuries. In fact, a lot of that gold and silver will power the Renaissance. Well, they don't need to do that anymore, because what's happening with the age of capitalism, the Industrial Revolution? What do you need Spanish for? However, you know, they want Spain resurrected as a bona fide monarch to take part in this balance of power, to have it evenly distributed. You know, they're thinking about all this. Why? Because of those ideas unleashed by the French Revolution that are going to effervesce all through the 19th century in Europe, and eventually kill the monarchs. Liberalism, democracy, republicanism, secularism, socialism, nationalism, parliamentarianism. I mean, all these ideas are effervescing among the people. So it's kind of late to try to cap them, but that's what the monarchs are going to try to do. However, for Spain to be included into this balance of power, have to have an empire. Congress of Verona, 1822. Many of these monarchs want to have a French army come to North America, or the New World, let's put it that way, and get that empire back for the Spanish. And so in 1823, what does President Monroe do? The Monroe Doctrine? Europeans, stay out. Now, we're doing something new here. They're called republics. You know, the few colonies the Europeans have here, there's nothing much the United States can do about that. We don't have the power for it. They don't want any new colonies being implemented here by the Europeans. You know who backs this? The British. The British back this. Why? They're moving into the Middle East. Why do they want to come back here for? You know, again, this thing known as Iraq, it's not known as Iraq back then, it's Mesopotamia, but this thing known as Iraq is influencing American history in the 18th going into the 19th centuries. Why? You know, the British were the consummate imperialist power, colonial power. One of the reasons is they knew geography. They know how to read maps. You know, that thing we don't do too well with anymore here? And so they take a look at this thing known as Mesopotamia, and they say two rivers here, the Tigris and the Euphrates rivers. Well, some colonial competitor, Tsarist Russia, comes to mind here, could go down those two rivers into the Persian Gulf, through the Strait of Hormuz, and you're right at colonial India, the Arabian Sea. There's no Pakistan yet, 1947. That's 1947, it's down the road. Can't have that's the crown jewel of the British Empire. So in 1763, the British East India Company, a forerunner of such states within a state like Halliburton, ExxonMobil, companies like this, they begin moving into the Middle East. They open up in Basra in 1763 in the southeast corner of what's going to be known as Iraq. A British consulate will follow 5 years later. 1798, they move north into Baghdad. A British consulate will follow 4 years later by 1802. See what's happening here? They're moving their Indian Empire west to plug that gap. Why do they want to come back here for? They don't. However, they don't want their European competitors coming back in the New World either. And so they will back the Monroe Doctrine. Again, you're beginning to see this, and it's unmistakable even at this point, this growing affinity or coming together of the United States and the British. Even though many Tories look down on us. But strategically speaking, is this getting to be important? Yes. And so what happens here? The British and French aren't going to have an empire here to speak of anymore. Yeah, the Spanish still have Puerto Rico and Cuba, big deal. And they're going to lose that. They're out of Florida by this point. And so America's going to keep expanding west. Manifest destiny. Remember that one? Yeah, manifest destiny. Interesting what you're seeing develop here in the 19th century. Manifest destiny. We are building a contiguous empire. In other words, we're on the same landmass, but we're moving west, taking this land. You know who else is doing the same sort of thing? Tsarist Russia. They have a manifest destiny going. They don't have a far-flung empire. They are expanding on the Eurasian landmass, east, west, north, south. Only they have a bigger landmass. Unlike the British Empire, the French, the Belgians, the Dutch, so on and so forth, the British Empire, is India next to Britain? No. Is Africa next to Britain and France? No. So they have to have naval power, and they're developing empires overseas. Not so the United States and Tsarist Russia. They're on a landmass, and they're expanding on that landmass at the expense of their neighbors. That's exactly what they're doing here. And so you see the future of these two countries being put together now. 1846-48 war. Mexican-American war. What happens to Mexico holdings north of the Rio Grande? They're gone. Who has that territory? The United States. Interesting here. Of course, this will all be interrupted for a short period of time by that hiccup known as the Civil War. North and the South. However, in between there, the Napoleon III in France was looking to resurrect France as a great power. Interesting what you see here. You go back to 1774, there's a treaty known as Kutchuk-Kanyarja. I don't expect you to remember that name. Where the Tsarist Russia arm-twisted the Ottomans. The Ottomans are falling here, too, in the 18th century. They're growing weaker, especially after that 100 years war with the Safavid Persians for control of Mesopotamia. And the Tsarist Russia is going to arm-twist the Ottomans into having the Eastern Orthodox Church oversee Christian interests in the whole so-called Holy Land, right? You think the Vatican liked that one? No, I don't think so. And so by the very early 1850s, Napoleon III is going to arm twist the Ottomans and having the Catholic Church oversee Christian interests in the Middle East. And here is where that's one of the causes, really, of the Crimean War. Interesting how the sides are chosen up here. The Tsarist Russia is going to grab a couple of provinces in what's going to later be known as Romania. It's still part of the Ottoman Empire. And so the British, the French will join the Ottomans in going to war with Russia. This leads to the Crimean War. There's a lot more to the Crimean War going on here than Errol Flynn and Nigel Bruce charging up the Balaclava Heights. A lot more going on here.
It was the bloodiest war.
In the 19th century. Yeah, in Europe, right, or that area. 500,000 men gone in 33 months. Some historians have said that quite possibly, if events had panned out, this would have been the Great War in Europe. Keep in mind what you saw here. Tsarist Russia taking on the British, the French, and the assistance of the Ottomans. Now that's interesting. If you break it down in religious fashion here, you got the Eastern Orthodox on one side, Catholics, Anglicans/Protestants, and Muslims on the other side. That's an interesting group. However, keep in mind, I mentioned before about that balance of power these monarchs had put together. Within the overall balance of power, you get to the end of the 1718, a holy alliance is put together. That was Tsarist Russia, the Habsburgs, and the Prussians to oversee Eastern and Central Europe amid the larger scope here. However, you would have thought that if the Russians are going to war with the British and the French and the Ottomans, that perhaps the Habsburgs and the Prussians would have helped them? No. What do you think happened to that alliance after this war? There is no more alliance. The Russians are on their own. Which is why, interesting here too, that during the American Civil War, guess who was one of our biggest boosters? I'm talking a booster for the North. Tsarist Russia. Abe, don't lose this war. You beat the South and keep the United States together. Why is that? Well, because down the road, they're looking at us as a possible ally against the British and the French. How good of an ally are we going to be if we're divided into two countries instead of one? They were one of, in fact, a Russian fleet will visit New York in 1863. So Tsarist Russia was a booster for the North. Didn't want us to lose. Keep in mind, too, with Napoleon the Third. You know, it's interesting here that, again, the British, the French, and the Ottoman Empire, you know, British and the French are going to supply, are going to assist the Ottomans. One of the reasons the British will is they want to maintain the Ottomans as that buffer. They don't want Tsarist Russia getting into the Middle East. The French, again, Napoleon III is looking to resurrect France as a great power. They're going to supply a good portion of the ground troops from Europe. Guess who's going to supply the majority of the naval power? The British. Of course, the question is, well, if the British and the French are colonial competitors, why are they, well, you know, again, the British oversee the whole picture here. They see the Ottomans as maintaining that buffer to Tsarist Russia. And so they'll join the French, but they don't trust the French. By getting involved in the war, they can keep an eye on the French at the same time. Now, there's no honor among thieves here. There really isn't. There's no honor among thieves. At the same time, what is Napoleon III going to do eventually here? Isn't he going to send troops to Mexico? Remember Maximilian on the throne in Mexico City? Yeah, Don Benito Juarez is going to have to go into the Mexican hinterland with that guerrilla movement. And so French troops will be in Mexico. Maximilian was actually out of the Habsburg family. He was a lackey for the French. And so Napoleon III will put French troops into Mexico. You know, and so is that a violation of the Monroe Doctrine? One would think so. You know, and you can't blame Lincoln for not doing anything about it. He's got the Confederacy to fight. How's that going to work? Throw out the French. It's not going to work. He can't. However, when the war is over, the Civil War is over with, Lincoln's assassinated in April 1865. President Johnson, Andrew Johnson, remember he'll be impeached later on, but Andrew Johnson sends 50,000 Union troops down to the Texas border under the command of Phil Sheridan. There's a possibility of America and France going to war here. It won't happen because in 1866, Otto von Bismarck will get together with the Italians and defeat the Austrians. And he will unite the German states into what's going to be known as, later on, the German Empire, or let's call it Germany. You know, there was this thing in Europe called German dualism. Some German states were run by the Prussians, some run by the Austrians. That comes out of the Congress of Vienna. There had to be a time when one of them was going to find out who's going to be the big he bull in the corral, and it's Prussia. And so now Napoleon III understands what that reality means. He's going to bring those troops from Mexico home. Well, what do you think happens to Maximilian? He's done, 1867. He's finished. But we do not go to war with the French. Now, what's interesting here is America after the Civil War. We will have the United States will have an army. Get this. It will have, and this is unheard of at the time. We'll have an army of 2,213,000 men on April 9, 1865. That is the largest armed force in the history of North America up to this point. This is a time where the United States is beginning to become a modern state. The North organizes its industry and finance and people for war. The handwriting's on the wall here. Interesting one. That's why the South wasn't going to win this. The South didn't have the industry, didn't have the manpower. And so in 1864-65, General Grant and General Sherman are going to unleash that war of attrition, which is really economic war, and destroy the Southern economy. Modern war, total war, is being waged here. Interesting what you see develop here. General Grant will hold down Lee's Army of Northern Virginia in Virginia, and he will, you know, and it'll be up to Sherman to go from one side of the Confederacy to the other on a 60-mile wide path of destruction, burning the cotton bales, destroying the farms, absconding with the food and livestock, tearing up railroad track, destroying the rolling stock. Any factories or centers of production, burn them down until he goes to the coast. The South can't fight this. There is a historian, his last name is Weegley, who later write that if you look at how the British and the United States waged their strategic bombing campaign against Nazi Germany in World War II, go back and see how Grant and Sherman waged the war of attrition against the Southerners in 1864-65. Instead of doing it from horseback, you're now doing it from the air. It's the same principle, the very same principle, which is why I've always maintained America, unless you're from England, you would know, or Poland or China or Russia, whatever the case may be, or France too, Americans for the most part have no clue as to what total war is. The closest you'll get is talk to a Marine who was on Tarawa or Iwo Jima or Okinawa. Talk to an American GI who was in the Battle of the Bulge. Talk to a young GI who was stuck in that hellhole known as the Pusan Perimeter in Korea. You know? Or a Marine stuck in frozen Chosin in 1950, winter 1950. But Americans have no clue. They really don't. The only Americans who ever really had a clue were those Southerners of 1864-65, because they were on the receiving end of it. And so by April 9, 1865, they have no army to speak of. Their government is gone. Their way of life has been cast into the dustbin of history. Their country no longer exists. Their economy is in tatters. They're broke. And their future? Bleak. Those Americans, the Southerners of 1864-65, knew total war because they were on the receiving end of it. After that, for the most part, no, Americans don't know. No, they don't know what it's like in some of the European countries. You know, we lose 405,399 dead in World War II. What's that? Chinese lost 15 million. Soviets will lose upwards of 25 million. So what's 405,399 dead? Let's take the morality out of the figures for a while. That's nothing. That's 1/3 of 1% of the American population. Soviets will lose 1/7. So it's interesting what you see here. Interesting what you see. However, after the Civil War, what happens to, you know, America for the most part had been an agrarian nation. That's changing after 1865 in particular. You know, we have 144,000 factories and centers of production after the Civil War, even after the Civil War. By 1900, that will be 335,000. Manufactured goods. You know, America will produce some $2 billion in manufactured goods around 1860. By 1900, $11.5 billion. It goes up 5.5 times. You see what's happening to the country here? This evolution of capitalism and the age of the Industrial Revolution, it's snowballing. We're uninhibited. We are not under threat. We are expanding, expanding, expanding. Population is going up. And our understanding of this is fascinating. You know, you are seeing as we go along here, more and more Americans basically, you know, big finance is taking its place here, big business is taking its place here. They understand by the 1890s that the American population can't digest all the goods that we're producing. So how do you sell the overflow? Overseas? Yeah. Is that going to change the American posture here? Yes. So this manifest destiny, this great quest across this land, is going to change by 1898. Interesting here too, John Adams always said that the wide ownership of land is conducive to having a functioning system of representative government. You don't have to have a ranch. Don't a lot of you people have a house? And that house is on, what, a half acre, a quarter acre, a fifth acre, a third of an acre, right? Do you folks own a ranch here? No, you don't. But do you pay the property tax on that house and that land? Yeah, you do. Does that give you the right to go down to the common council meeting some night if you don't like something and vent your liver? Of course it does. This is what Adams meant. However, having said that, by the mid-1890s, America is now the world's ranking economic power. We've displaced the British, and the Germans are on the rise too here. And so having said that, yes, it's understood at this point that the American public can't buy all the goods we're producing. We have to push overseas. And what happens in the War of 1898? Spanish-American War. We now go to war with Spain. We have been building a navy since the 1880s, the New Steel Navy. That will be the base for that wonderful two-ocean navy we're going to have when we get into the Second World War. The seeds are laid here. And so on April 25, 1898, we will go to war with the Spanish. What's interesting here is we had an army of 26,000 men. Now this army, for the most, keep in mind, 2,213,000 men on April 9, 1865. In 2 years, that army will be down to 57,000 men. By 1874, it's down to 26,000 men. We don't want a big army. That goes back to what the founding fathers said. We don't want a big army. The citizen soldier, right? Most of the armies will be controlled by the governors. However, what you see in 1898, there has to be a change here. And so you have an army of 26,000 men and you're going to war. These guys have been fighting Plains Indians. We're no longer fighting Plains Indians. What are we doing? We're going to be taking on an army from one of those imperialist powers in Europe. Granted, it's not the British Army, it's not the French Army, it's not the Russians, it's not that German-trained Japanese Army. If we ever had to fight any of those armies, we would have got our clocks cleaned. It's the Spanish, and they're declining as a power. You know, it's always good if you're going to play baseball, you start in the minor leagues first. That's basically what this is. And we're going to defeat that army. What's fascinating here is, you know, you have an army of 26,000 men used to chasing Plains Indians. Now they're going to be fighting modern conventional war. And so if you have an army of 26,000 men, what do you think the logistics system is geared to? 26,000 men. McKinley puts out a call. He wants 150,000 more men. And many of these governors, some of these governors told him, you know, as far as the citizen soldiers went, my guys aren't fighting outside their state borders. You imagine if Malloy had told Obama that last year, my guys aren't going to Afghanistan. How far do you think that would have got? Governors got away with it back in the day. And so now he needs volunteers, so he puts out a call, 150,000 men. Now, how do you think a logistics system for 26,000 men is going to work with 180,000? Beg your pardon?
Strained.
Yeah, strained, that's a polite word.
Poorly.
In fact, beg your pardon?
Poorly.
Yeah. And so they're going to launch an amphibious operation from Tampa, Florida to Cuba. It was a major undertaking here. Consider yourself a soldier in one of these rust buckets going from Tampa Bay to Cuba, for the invasion of Cuba, unair conditioned, and you're going into the tropics, and you're in the same hold with maybe some mules that you need. How would you like that ride? And yet, in 20 years, show you where this country's going, in 20 years, we will move over 2 million men over 3,000 miles of ocean. Wow. But you see what happened with Manifest Destiny, this idea of John Adams saying, yes, it's the wide ownership of land is conducive to a functioning system of representative government, and that's what happens in the 19th century. It's common everyday people like yourselves who are looking to move out of the village they're in, the town they're in, the city they're in, because they want to make a better life, them and their family, right? They're going to move west. They're going to grab land. It's the common everyday Joe. That's our colonialism in the 19th century. The common everyday Joe. It's not the Army and Navy taking land. It's people. The Army will follow. The banker will follow. The businessman will follow. The railroads and the telegraph follow. That's how we spread. It's the common everyday Joe, really, that spreads this country or unites this country from Chesapeake Bay to the Golden Gate. However, in 1898, in that Spanish-American War, we're going to take Puerto Rico, we're going to take the Philippines, we're going to take Guam, we're going to solidify our grip on Hawaii, and Cuba becomes a free nation if you believe that one. And it's not Mom, Pa, Kettle doing this. It's the Army and the Navy. The country changes. Manifest Destiny now has a different agenda. It's no longer a program for expanding from Chesapeake Bay to the Golden Gate. It is now a program for globalism. And you see this 2 years later, when Teddy Roosevelt sends the Great White Fleet around the world. 16 battleships will go 46,000 miles and show the flag. They will leave Hampton Roads on December 16, 1907 and return to Hampton Roads on February 22, 1909. Boy, what happened here? What's interesting here is the Army. Shows you again where the country's going. The Army, you know, then everyone likes the Navy at this point. Everyone's in love with the Navy. The Army, they need some work. And so McKinley, after the war, the Spanish-American War, will hire a New York lawyer. Elihu Root will be a Secretary of War. He takes a look, you know, he's never been in the military before, but he thinks pretty good. And he will come out with what's known as the Root Reforms in 1899. The United States will now have a bona fide general staff. The Army War College will come along, 1903. Also, the old citizen soldier concept, as in your Second Amendment, remember that one? A well-regulated militia. The right for the people to bear arms shall not be infringed, right? Well, that's bolstered by the 1792 Militia Act, where the governors controlled the militias. Not Washington, the governors did. It was the type of military set, which is what many of the founders wanted. They did not want a large standing army. They thought it was a threat to the Republic. Interesting, when we became 13 states, we have 2,630 men. How are 2,630 regular soldiers going to guard 13 states? You think that's going to happen? No. The militias. Every white male, 18 to 45, is in the militia. And they bought their own gun, their own shirt, their own pants, their own shoes, their own powder, their own ball. Washington didn't do that. And guess who appointed the officers? The states. The states. And according to the 1792 Militia Act, you can, if you find the act, you can read it. These guys would be federalized for 3 months. That changes in 1903, the National Guard Act. They need bodies in the Philippines for that anti-guerrilla war. Imperialism. Now, the 1792 Militia Act is superseded by the National Guard Act of 1903. These so-called guardsmen now, which are no longer citizen soldiers, they're guardsmen now. They don't buy their own guns anymore. Guess who supplies the weapons? Washington. Modern weaponry. They will now train with the Army, with regular troops, 5 days a year, and now get paid for it. They have to meet 24 times a year on their own. And if they're federalized, it's no longer 3 months, it's now 9 months. 1908, subsidiary legislation. Now these guys can be sent overseas. Of course, an attorney general is going to reverse that. But then again, 1916, the National Defense Act of 1916. That's a big one, because a year later, we're in the First World War. These guys no longer meet, these guys no longer train with the regular troops for 5 days a year. It's now 15. And no longer will they meet just 24 times a year. It is now 48, and they're going to get paid for that. And oh, and by the way, if they're federalized, it's for the duration. You see what happened here? The governors are losing control of these state armies, if you want to call them that. And where's power going? To the center. It has to. You're taking your place on the world stage. Do you think you can honestly be a bona fide global power by, you know, federalizing guys who are untrained, virtually? You can't. I mean, picture if we still had the citizen soldier concept. You expect some guy from Jerkwater, Tennessee to be able to fly a $35 million Apache helicopter? I don't think that's happening. A professional armed force. And what the founders were concerned about is that that professional army would be a threat to the Republic. What is it Hitler said? Armies do not exist for peace. They exist solely for triumphant exertion in war. That's what Hitler said. And I can add to that with a colonel I used to work with up at Army Aviation magazine who once told me, today's wars, Mark, they're not for, he used to fly attack helicopters. He says, today's wars aren't for patriotism, they're for national interest. That's what he told me. I worked with this guy for 3 years. Interesting guy. Interesting guy. Interesting. Interesting. And so you see, by 1914, when this big war starts, and it starts as a European civil war, it's fought for European issues, colonialism for one. Who were the major colonial powers? The Europeans. Again, the British, the French, Tsarist Russia, Belgium, Holland, Italy jumps into this, the Germans jump into this, the Austro-Hungarian Empire. No, they're mostly European. And then the United States and Japanese are the latecomers. They jump into this. You know, the Japanese are interesting. You know, they're not white Christian. They're not a white Christian colonial power. They got round heads, yellow skin and slanted eyes. There goes the neighborhood. Who let them in? And so you see the world changing here. The world's changing. But for the most part, these are white Christian colonial powers from Europe who dictate the world agenda. But they're losing their grip here. The Great Navy Race. Most of the naval powers are European. Again, the British, the French, the Germans jump into the Tsarist Russia. Even the Austro-Hungarian Empire had some sort of navy, the Ottomans. Again, add the Japanese and Americans to this from outside Europe. Again, the globe's changing here. The competition between the monarchs in Europe. Oh, you know, weren't a lot of these monarchs related? Yeah. Wasn't Tsar Nicholas II a cousin to Kaiser Wilhelm II of Germany, right? Weren't both of these monarchs related to Edward VII and later George V of England? Of course they were. Who was Kaiser Wilhelm II's grandmother? Queen Victoria. It's a mafia setup. And you have to admit, folks, that some of these people, with the interbreeding going on, intellectually weren't the sharpest tools in the shed. I mean, with some of these people, you got to admit, there's some slates missing off the roofs. And yet they are playing Monopoly with real buildings on a real map board determining the fate of millions. In an era, again, of the Industrial Revolution, capitalism. People, not as many people tied to the land, they're mobile. Now we have airplanes. Now we have cars. How are they going to exist? They're not. They're not. And so this war, which, you know, some of these conflicts among these European, you know, colonial powers, they last a little while. You know, the loser would pull out, pay an indemnity, pull his troops out, and hope for better luck next time. That's not how this war is going to be fought. It's modern war based on the Industrial Revolution and the change in politics. You are now seeing the industrialization of war, the commercialization of war. That's what you're seeing here. The British and the French, Now, this war is going to help break them in the long run. Britain has $3.7 billion in investments and assets in this country. $3.7 billion in 1914. You know how much they're going to have left? $1.1 billion. They have to liquidate. The French are going to liquidate 75% of their assets here. And guess where that money's going to go?
US.
Yeah, that's it, US. America's changing. You know, by the time we get into this conflict, April 6, 1917, the federal government, you know, that thing the Tea Party types like to rail against, balloons here. You know, our Constitution, it was for limited government. That's our blueprint for government, for limited government. The government grows 500% for the short time we're in World War I. It will spend $22 billion for the short time we're in the war. Some economists have calculated that it costs this country $2 million an hour. This is more money than Washington had spent from 1791 to 1914. You see the change coming here? The War Industries Board. Here's a classic example where the country's going. Bernard Baruch and the War Industries Board. You know, your Constitution and Bill of Rights enshrines the right of the individual. Being founded as a republic, not unlike a democracy, which caters to the majority, our government was supposed to cater to the rights of the individual. But now, the War Industries Board. You don't run your company anymore for the most part. Guess who does? Washington. You know, you're concentrating power to fight this big war. It has to be done this way. You can't have 100 different people with big companies going one way or another. No, you got to concentrate this. And that's what's going to happen. You are now beginning to see the beginnings of the military-industrial complex. Big-time finance, Wall Street. You know, besides the $22 billion Washington's going to spend, we lend a lot of money to the British and the French, or to the Allies, but a lot of this went to the British and the French, $10, $12 billion. You know, and the bankers want it back. That's understandable. Isn't that what they're in business for? Lend money and get it back at a profit? Okay, we understand that. And so in April 6, 1917, when Wilson gets his declaration of war, then there's the analysis of this. You were taught in school, right? Well, how did we get involved in this war? Unrestricted submarine warfare, remember that one? Wilson told the Germans more than once, you know, you're going to force my hand here. But what else can the Germans do? That beautiful navy they built can't break out of the North Sea and Channel. Why? Because the superior Royal Navy has them blockaded. And so the Germans are going to have to rely on the submarine. If they can't get food in from the sea, well, then not the British aren't either, because we're going to sink their ships with the submarines. And in the New York Times, these guys are pirates, these submarine captains. They won't say that about American submariners in World War II. What was unacceptable in 1914, 1918 becomes a necessity from 39 to 45. You want the submersible to cut off or strangle your enemy. And that's what we're going to do to the Japanese. The Germans will try to do it to us in World War II. But that's true. There is truth to what I just said. However, let's look at the other side here. I mentioned before, our banks and the government had loaned some $10, $12 billion to the Allies here. How are you going to get that money back? You know, keep in mind, the other aspect of this is Russia. And we don't talk about our entry into the war this way. Russia bailing out in 1917. Why is that important? Because if the British and the French, you know, again, the Germans can send troops now from the Eastern Front to the Western Front. And believe me, let me I tell you this, the British and French are getting tired at this point. By 1917. In fact, the French army will mutiny. 54 divisions will mutiny in 1917. I'm not talking platoons, companies, and battalions. I'm talking whole divisions. Multiply those divisions by 12 to 14,000 men. See what kind of a number you get. And you can't shoot them all. They're tired. They're getting tired. So the American concern is obvious here. If the Germans are going to shift more troops to the Western Front, who's to guarantee that the Brits and the French are going to be able to keep up with the war until we can get enough troops over there? You know, are you and are you going to, if let's say in 1918 the Germans bring enough troops to bolster what they have on the Western Front and win, and the German General Staff can dictate peace terms in Paris, are you guaranteed you're going to get that $10-12 billion back? No, you're not. So how are you going to make sure you get it back? Send the doughboys and the Marines, you know, the collection squad. We're in the war. This is the age of reality besides seeing the commercialization of war. Guess what? America is now on the world scene. We are now a global power. And we have, and it's interesting here too, April 6, 1917 gets us involved in European affairs. Have we gotten out ever since? Again, go back to 1823, you know, the Monroe Doctrine. President Monroe is saying, Europeans, stay out. What did we do on April 6, 1917? America is in. And we have yet to get out. Interesting what you saw develop here. The change is unmistakable. You know, a company like DuPont. Here's an example of how things are changing here. DuPont, remember that company? Yeah. They're going to produce, after a while, 40% of the munitions for the Allies. You want to know where the country's going? That company was $20 a share in 1914. It'll be $1,000 in 1918. Boy, how would you like some of that action, huh? You see where it's going here? It's fascinating. Again, a cog here in this what's going to be known later on as the military-industrial complex. And I can tell you by doing research where I am in Army Aviation magazine, prior even to our sojourn in the Mexico in 1916, which nobody talks about anymore, nobody wanted a contract with the Army. There's no future in that one. Number one, where are the big contracts? And number two, the Army's sometimes late in paying their bills. Sometimes they don't pay it. Who wants them as a customer? After 1945, everybody and his uncle wants the Army as a customer. Changes the country. At the same time, changes your government. It's interesting what you saw develop here. And one man will understand this. Franklin D. Roosevelt. He was Under Secretary of the Navy. He is Under Secretary of the Navy. And it's kind of late here, folks. You know, when the American public does not want to be involved in Europe after 1918. Been there, done that. Yet the businessman, the banker, and the military understand something different. We are now a global power. It's too late to get off the world stage. We're in. That's the way it's going to be. And what's fascinating about this is, I mentioned when I started, two countries will eventually win this war, the United States and the Soviet Union. And what I find fascinating about this, the whole aspect of this, is that the two of them will be ostracized from European politics after Versailles. The United States, because it wanted to be in the end, mostly the people, and on top of that, you had the political problems here between Woodrow Wilson and Henry Cabot Lodge. Keep in mind, Wilson can sign all the treaties he wants. Who has to ratify them? The Senate, right? According to the Constitution. And Henry Cabot Lodge will get enough people in Congress. They will not ratify the Versailles Treaty, so we do not take part in the League of Nations, one of Woodrow Wilson's babies. So now you're gonna rely on two countries, bled white in the trenches, Britain and France, not a police Europe. Keep in mind, you know, the British lose 965,000 dead in 4 years. The French, 1,565,000 dead in 4 years to keep their colonies. That's what some of this was about. And the Germans lose 1,770,000 dead and lose their colonies. And Tsarist Russia is no more, and they're ostracized from Europe. because they had fallen sway to godless communism. So the two countries that could have helped the British and the French police Europe are out. Is that going to make it easier in the end for fascist Italy and Nazi Germany? Yes. And so in 1939, Hitler will jumpstart this war with Stalin's connivance, and we're off and running. For the most part, most of the world's problems, or most of the war, is fought in Europe. However, the war will change in December 1941. Hitler is stopped at Moscow, the Japanese bomb Pearl Harbor, and now the United States and Soviet Union, the world's ranking number one and number two industrial powers, are now on the same team. And who do you think is going to take over this war in 1942? Those two countries. And they will win it in 45. And the world's going to change. And we have yet to get off the world stage. And as of 1945, if you take a look at the situation, this is a country, I'm talking the United States, that emerges from this war no longer a global power, but a superpower. We're virtually, again, this goes back to what I mentioned before, that Americans, for the most part, have no clue of total war. We weren't touched. Our industry proceeds unimpeded. Americans aren't spending their time in bomb shelters, except for the Aleutians, if you want to include that. America's really not invaded. And we come out of this war with more gas than we can burn, more money than we can spend, more food than we can eat, and more clothes than we can wear. We have the bomb. What's not to like? And we only lose 405,399 dead. One third of 1% of the American population is killed. What's not to like here? I'm taking the morality out of those figures for just a moment. And this sets the tone to where we are now. Interesting what you've seen develop here. Which is why, again, April 6, 1917 is an underappreciated day here. It is a day of greater significance than December 7, 1941 or September 11, 2001. It's a very important day. And again, going back to what you and I were discussing earlier, you know, again, I don't believe in a World War I or World War II. To me, there's only one war, Great War, 1914, 18, 39, or 45. Because you can't have the second one without the other. It's not going to work. Yet it's the 1914, 19, and 18 end of this conflict which has impacted us all out of proportion to the number of years it was fought. Isn't that when the Middle East will be transformed? The British and the French draw those borders through clannish associations, tribal affiliations, religious differences, and ethnic passions, and the world has been happy at that result ever since. Ukraine, that comes out of this. Libya, that comes out of this. Vietnam comes out of this. Products of World War I/colonialism. Haven't been able to get away from this. Still fighting it. Even the Soviet Union is now gone. Now, although George Kennan was right, whether it's Tsarist Russia or Stalinist Russia or Khrushchev's Soviet Union or Brezhnev's Soviet Union or Putin's Russia, Russia is Russia in the end. A lot of truth to that one. Anybody have any questions or comments? Yes?
Taking you back to the Spanish-American War, where we gained possessions, not Cuba. Why not Cuba?
We did, really. If you read the Platt Amendment of 1903, we virtually had the Cuban government in our pocket. They aren't allowed to have any foreign troops come in there. We can put troops there if we want. We virtually controlled their resources, especially the sugar trade, which we wanted to do. No, we more or less have control of Cuba, with really without having mass amount of troops there. And we're using the dollar to do that. This is where you're beginning to see the American dollar being used as a bludgeon. And I'll give you another case in point. When the war is over in 45, and you know, again, you see the primacy of America. In 1940, Britain is actually a $16 billion creditor nation. In 1945, they are a $12 billion debtor. They're going broke. They only have $12 million in gold left. So they need $3.7 billion to tide them over. And they need money. You know, keep in mind with Bretton Woods, what started here with the Spanish-American War with the dollar is now on steroids by 1944. You've had World War I. You've had the Depression. You're winding down what you call World War II. Somebody's money has to bolster the world. That affords us a lot of advantages. Britain needs money, $3.7 billion. Sure, you can have that money. We'll gladly give you that money. But $930 million of it has to be spent here or no deal. Number two, sure, you can have that money. But your exports have to be paid for in either dollars or gold. Keep in mind, the United States has 77% of the world's gold at this point. $29 billion in 1945, because people had to pay for war goods one way, if not lend-lease. And so you see here, I also tell the British, sure, you can have that money, but don't think you're going to your Commonwealth compadres for a better deal, because if you do, then there is no deal. You see what we're doing with the dollar here? We're using it as a bludgeon. The Egyptians were another one. Sure, you can have a few bucks. But when it comes to airline traffic going from Egypt to Europe and back, guess who the first airline companies are you're going to hire? Not the Europeans, Americans. Ethiopia, hey, you can have a few bucks, but guess what? When it comes to building air bases here, not the British, United States. You see what we're doing with the dollar? We're acting like a big power. That's exactly what we're doing here. And so the dollar is being, you don't need a lot of troops. The dollar. The dollar, each dollar bill is a soldier now. And so since the Spanish-American War with Cuba, you've seen what happens here.
But it's different. You know, the difference I see is Guam, Puerto Rico, possessions.
Right.
Of the United States. Cuba apparently didn't fall into that category. We may have had control as a result of the economy.
Well, we didn't have
why
to.
Why did we not assume Cuba as a possession, as we did with...
Well, politically and economically, it really was. But we didn't have to put troops there. Economics. You know, and it's interesting here, too, Cuba was, under Spain, under that tariff wall for sugar, after we took political control, they eliminated that. And so the American sugar interest took control of Cuban sugar interests. Now, that's interesting. And you did that how? With the dollar. So we are learning to use our currency, which is becoming more important, as a wedge for foreign policy. It's interesting what you, in fact, George Kennan says it well here. This is George Kennan. This is 1948. Keep in mind, George Kennan was one of the co-authors of the Marshall Plan. Now, it's nice. I mean, I know I was brought up on this as a kid. Oh, we saved the world. If it wasn't for us, the Marshall Plan. You know, the Europeans would be out to lunch. You know, Japanese, so on and so forth. Right? I remember that. I remember being told that. Well, one of the reasons you have the Marshall Plan is you've got, out of 16,112,000 people in the military, 15 million are going to be mustered out. You better find a job for them, because if not, they're not going to be happy campers here, 1945, 46, 47. So what does the Marshall Plan do? It fashions Europe and Japan as a dumping ground for American goods. That's what it does. In fact, Mr. Kennan alludes to this. Interesting what he says here. The U.S. has about 50% of the world's wealth, but only 6.3% of its population. In this situation, we cannot fail to be the object of envy and resentment. Gee, you think? Our real task in the coming period is to devise a pattern of relationships which will permit us to maintain this position of disparity without positive detriment to our national security. To do so, we will have to dispense, get this one, we will have to dispense with all sentimentality and daydreaming, and our attention will have to be concentrated everywhere on our immediate national objectives. We need not deceive ourselves. We need not deceive ourselves that we can afford the luxury of altruism and world benefaction. We should cease to talk about such vague and unreal objectives as human rights, raising living standards, and democratization. The day is not far off when we are going to have to deal in straight power concepts. The less we are hampered by idealistic slogans, the better. Now, is that a big power talking? Yes. Now, if you want additional one here, let's go 6 years down the road. Remember Jimmy Doolittle? 30 seconds over Tokyo fame, right? The Doolittle raid, right? Well, in 1954, he was picked by President Eisenhower to do a report. And the report is, get a load of this one, which the president has a right to do. Report on the covert activities of the Central Intelligence Agency. Now, this is 6 years down the road. Talking about how we should use the CIA. Now, this is Jimmy Doolittle. In carrying out of this policy in order to reach minimal standards for national safety under present world conditions, two things must be done. First, this is the introduction to this report, by the way. First, the agencies charged by law with the collection, evaluation, and distribution of intelligence must be strengthened and coordinated to the greatest practicable degree. This is the primary concern of the National Security Council and must be accomplished at the national policy level. These elements of the problem that fall within the scope of our directive are dealt with in the report which follows. The second consideration is less tangible but equally important. It is now clear that we are facing an implacable enemy whose avowed objective is world domination by whatever means and at whatever cost. There are no rules in such a game. Hitherto acceptable norms of human conduct do not apply. If the United States is to survive, long-standing American concepts as fair play must be reconsidered. We must develop effective espionage and counter-espionage services and must learn to subvert, sabotage, and destroy our enemies by more clever, more sophisticated, and more effective methods than those used against us. It may become necessary that the American people be made acquainted with, understand, and support this fundamentally repugnant philosophy.
Concern for communism.
Yeah, that's why you have Under God and the Pledge of Allegiance in 1954. It wasn't in the Pledge of Allegiance in 1887. So it's interesting how you see the country moving ahead here. To the point where Obama is sitting in the Oval Office before his term is over with a list done by the CIA every Tuesday sending drones to kill people. Exclusive of the rule of law. That's where this has led to. Interesting how you've seen the country develop. What happened to the rule of law? Now, yes. Now, out the window, right. That was to have been expected. I mean, you can't take your place on the world stage and expect a proper system of representative government to result, especially when you want to have an empire. It doesn't work that way. Same thing happened to Rome. It's happened to numerous other countries. It's the way it works. So, anyway, anybody else have any questions or comments? Now that I ruined your afternoon. Yes, sir.
You haven't mentioned China once. And right now, they are the number two economic power.
Yeah.
We're looking at East-West now, okay?
Correct. You know, you bring up a great point here. China, like India, let's say, at one point were colonial satraps. Now they're making their presence felt on the world stage. Again, this is what you've seen change since 45, when America was the only game in town. Those are the days, you know, when you came home from the war, you could go get a job and expect to be there 30, 35 years and retire with a nice pension, right? Those are the days, and I vaguely remember this, late 50s into the 60s, when people countries for the most part were what? Buying American cars, television sets, radios, so on and so forth, right? What happened to that? And so, to have expected that to last forever, that's ludicrous. Now you're seeing where America was once the only game in town, now you got competition, right? The EU, China, India, how about Japan? Even Brazil was trying to be a competitor, South Africa. I mean, again, it's no longer, now we have kibitzers in the game here. And so internally, how has it affected us? Can you expect to get a job for 30 or 35 years and expect to retire with a nice pension?
With the government. In public service, you can.
Yeah.
Not in the private sector.
But the fact of the matter is, on the whole playing field has changed. And so we're not the only game in town anymore. So it's interesting what you see here. It's interesting what you've seen develop. But yes, you know, and the question can be, the point can be made going into China and India and Japan, let's say. And let's not forget Singapore as the world's largest port authority. Is economic and political power transferring to Asia? Some people say yes. And so perhaps, looking at it over the long term, perhaps the first to try that were the Japanese in the 1890s. I remember my father always saying when I was a kid, he says, boy, you know, this is back in the 60s, I must have been about 10, 12 years old, and he would say, if the Chinese ever wake up, they'll turn Japan into Long Island. What's happening?
Yeah. Well, most of the industries that grew in Japan in the 60s have migrated to China and Southeast Asian countries.
Yep. Yeah.
Even out of Singapore to lower costs like Indonesia, Vietnam, and Bangladesh. So
right.
It's a cycle.
But Japan has always had that weakness. They're shy of a lot of resources, natural resources, oil being one of them. And so, you know, China for quite a while was virtually self-sufficient in oil. However, now because of this expansion of their economy, they want to foster good relations with the Middle East. In fact, they're Iran's largest oil customer. And so you've seen what's happened here. So yeah, that's a good point. And they're only going to become more powerful. I mean, that day's coming. And so, yes, are they a bona fide competitor now? Yes. Yes, they are. So it's interesting what you're going to see come down here 5 years, 10 years, 20 years down the road. And every time, you know, because I'm sure there's some in Japan who are a little shaky about us right now with our economy. And every once in a while there's noises made that with that Japanese constitution, they weren't supposed to devote any more than 1% of their gross national product to defense. You know, every once in a while that comes up, well, maybe 1.5%, 1.75%, 2%, 2.5%. Every time they do, what does Peking and Seoul and Pyongyang do? Boy, they squeal like stuck pigs. Yeah. And you know, some people here, I've heard this.
Long memories.
That's it.
Yeah, right.
That's it.
And the Japanese were brutal.
Oh,
brutal.
Oh yes. And so they don't forget this. And you know, I've been in a company of some Americans who will say, "Well, that's a big deal for." If you lived or heard the stories from your family, now you know why there's a big deal. Interesting. Again, you know, do we teach history well enough in this country? Apparently not. Yeah. So yeah.
Roosevelt though, who kind of really built up a navy, maybe more imperialistic.
In fact,
and now we have Donald Trump. We seem to be maybe trying to be more protectionist, but I don't think it could be protectionist.
Well, you know, again, getting into this thing called Pax Americana, American Empire. Interesting here what Mr. Roosevelt says in 1940. Get a load of this one. As you know, the British need money in this war. They own lots of things all over the world, such as tramways and electric light companies. Well, in carrying on this war, the British may have to part with that control. And we, perhaps, can step in and arrange, make financial arrangements for eventual local ownership. It is a terribly interesting thing, and one of the most important things for our future trade is to study it in that light. Is he, you know, you could title that Pax Americana. And he's talking about what's going to be his ally. You know, so what does that tell you? It's every man for himself?
The Chinese seem to be pretty astute. I mean, we had an opportunity after September 11th, okay, where the world loved us, okay, but it wasn't until we went into Iraq and we opened up a whole can of worms there, okay, it got more involved, okay. And we put a lot of resources into that region, okay, and we've not really gotten anything back for it, okay. The Chinese, they have the Eastern mentality is more patient. They can wait a long time.
A long term.
They can wait long term. Let us make a mess. Let us go bankrupt, okay, or whatever. I don't think we will, but
that's what Osama bin Laden was pushing for.
Yeah, but they're dude. They'll wait for the opportunities, okay, to expand their perimeter.
Well, that's what Mao Zedong said with his version of guerrilla war. We're in it for the long haul. And yeah, he was a man of his word. They fought 20 years. Ho Chi Minh was another one. Fought over 30 years. So yeah, but then again, when those people get involved in that, what else do they have to do? You take an American kid and throw him in there to fight that. He's leaving his girlfriend, a comfortable bed, maybe wanting to go to college, a night on the town, and leaving his car home. He's leaving a lot. So if there's no real patriotic angle to this, like there was in 41. I mean, talk to some of these kids that go to these places. I'm glad I'm home. That doesn't sound like 1944-45. I'm glad I'm home, but we're going to win this. I don't hear that anymore.
Yeah, I could see us going into World War II, and certainly we should have gone into World War II if we go through that as a separate war, but what would have happened if we had not entered World War I? What, have you tried to think of how that would have played out?
Yeah, it's interesting what you saw here, because the war having got out of control at this point. A lot of this is for markets, a lot of this is for colonies, a lot of this is for power. And so America staying out of it was kind of, at this point, I won't say impossible, but improbable. Again, we're taking our place on the world stage. And you know what's interesting is when you go back to that, you look at something like the Committee of Public Information, which was fashioned in 1917, and people like Walter Lippmann, Edward Bernays. Now there's a guy you ought to get to know. He was the nephew of Sigmund Freud. Became an expert in molding opinion. He will be one of those that will sell this war here as a war for democracy. He will also be hired when the war is over with by George Washington Hill, the owner of American Tobacco Company, and Bernays will later sell millions upon millions upon millions of Lucky Strike cigarettes. He wrote a book. It's called Propaganda in 1928. Interesting. Again, the modernization of America, we're now getting involved in this to get into these conflicts. And so when you see, go from 1917 and then go to 2002, 2003, oh, we're bringing democracy to Iraq. Well, number one, America was founded as a republic. What the hell gives us the right to bring a form of government to another country to which we ourselves were not founded on? Who gave us that right? And so, yes, you see, and you know, Americans are busy with their lives and so on and so forth, so I don't think some of them really sat down and think about this stuff. No, and plus you're divorced from these wars anyway. Again, this isn't 1942. This isn't 1942. But America staying out of the 1914, 1918 conflict, there were some who wanted us in, and we're going to get in. And of course, again, there's a lot of financial reasons for this, material reasons for this. You see the decline of the British and French colonial powers. Somebody has to take their place. And in 1945, when the British and French can no longer do it, who's going to have to look after the colonial aspirations for the West? We are the only country able to do so. And so, which is one of the reasons why Franklin D. Roosevelt will make the deal with Abdulaziz Ibn Saud on Valentine's Day, 1945. American military protection for Saudi Arabia versus preferential access to the kingdom's crude, and every president, be he Democrat and Republican, has catered to that agenda ever since. And when I get in some of these conversations, every once in a while I get that one person, they'll say, well, Americans don't die for oil. They don't fight for oil. I said, well, not to be impertinent, but you know, historically speaking, I don't know where you've been since 1917. Oil revolutionizes war in that end of the conflict, dominates the war from 39 to 45. Without oil, where are you going? Nowhere.
Yeah, Congress seems to drive a lot of the decisions.
Well, you know, at this stage of the game, you know, what we were founded at, and again, whenever you...
Our Constitution was basically written to expedite, facilitate commerce. We have the Declaration of Independence, but when you look at the Constitution, it's about facilitating commerce.
A lot of founders thought that commerce would keep the peace. You have something I want, I have something you want. We'll trade. What do you need a large navy for? Trade. Well, we know what happened with that one. But, and so yes, your Constitution was written for a limited form of government, which catered to the right of the individual. And your Bill of Rights, the attached Bill of Rights, is to protect you from the infringement of government. But go back to what I said earlier. The idea of grabbing land across this great country, it's the regular run-of-the-mill Joe that does most of that. And so this is what John Adams was trying to say here, you know, that the wide ownership of land is conducive to a functioning system of representative government, but as soon as we go overseas now, it's no longer the common everyday Joe grabbing land in the Philippines, it has to be the Army and Navy. Big finance, big corporations, so manifest destiny changes. And since they make more money, are they going to change your mode of government? What do you have now? You got a corporate state now. That's what you are, a corporate state. And so the whole, it changes the country. How to change the country. So, yeah, it's interesting what you've seen develop here. Yes?
I want to know when you're coming back and what you're going to speak about.
Tomorrow night, I'm actually going to be at the Greenwich Library.
Here.
Oh, here? I sent them, I said, if you want a single talk, like I did that Eleanor Roosevelt talk, or this one today, November marks the 100th anniversary of the Balfour Declaration. That's in November.
It's a long time to wait.
I also, you know what? You got to push them a little bit. No, I offered to do the Nazi Revolution in the fall. 1919, 1934. You know, when everyone talks about Nazi Germany, it's usually what, 1933 to 45? Well, what happened from 1919 to 1934? You know, you forget about the Weimar Republic. You forget about how the Nazi Party formed, the Munich, the attempted Munich Putsch. Yeah, I mean, you forget about all this. And that's important. And people like, which nobody talks about, Ernst Röhm. So I'll talk about him. He's a fascinating character. You ever see pictures of Ernst Röhm? Looks like Oliver Hardy with a scar on his face. And that's where that resemblance ends. He was a rampant homosexual by the time he was 25. But he was in charge of Hitler's stormtroopers. And if you were the type of person that was a little leery about going down a dark alley at night, you won't find too many people better than Röhm with a busted chair, chain, pipe, broken bottle. Yeah, he was a tough customer. So much for homosexuals being, you know. Oh, no. Oh, yeah. Anything for a fight. A tough customer. So I offered to do that. And then I'm putting together another one, too. I'll call it Roadblocks to Republic. It'll be things like, which I didn't talk about really before, the Newburgh incident, things of this nature, where George Washington put down a potential revolt in the Continental Army in 1783. That's interesting. In fact, he will shoot two soldiers. So, nobody talks about that end of George Washington. So, interesting. But we'll see. It depends on what they want to do.